If you've got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 20 to 32. Let me read to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, from verse 20. When we come together, therefore, into one place, that is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating every one taken before other his own supper, and one is hungry and another is drunken. What have you not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. From verse 23. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the new testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink this cup, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, and eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many asleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Verse 20. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. This is not the way to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry, and another is drunken. What? Have you not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. It was a letter Paul wrote to the Corinthians about 2,000 years ago. In the night when Jesus was to be betrayed, Jesus observed the Passover with his disciples. When the Passover meal was over, after Judas Iscariot left the scene, probably, Jesus constituted the New Testament. It was after their Passover meal. We read from the book of Jeremiah what it was exactly. It was a practice among the Jews, and also something of that shade is woke in our culture also. When somebody died, after the days of mourning, the head of the family, to break that fast, to break that sorrow, we call that in Tamil Dukkha Nivirthi. To break that sorrow, the head of the family will take a bread. He will break it. He'll say the blessing. He'll break it. Give to every member of that family. Maybe it could be a grandfather or a father or uncle or somebody, the head of that family. If you see the Jewish tradition, they split the Jewish tradition into different groups, tribes, tribe of Judah, tribe of Benjamin, tribes. The tribes are split into families. The tribes are split into families. The families are split into houses. The houses are split into individuals. The house is split into individuals. So in Jewish tradition, the house is the nuclear of the family. There will be no stranger in it. The bond servant and those who are born to the bond servants, they also belong to that household. So when say there's no stranger, there's no other family member. But this occasion was not just for the house, it was for the family. So somebody has lost his father, somebody has lost his mother, they'll be very sad. So to give infuse confidence in them, the father will break the bread, or the tata will break the bread. Give to everybody. Eat, take and eat. Similarly, he will bless the cup and give to everybody. Take and drink. It is something like a Dukkha Nivirthi Kuta. In that occasion, they speak about the person who lived. The very purpose of speaking about the person in that occasion, though it was going with the Passover, it is after the Passover. The very purpose of talking about that person, they always say, this is what your father expected of you. This is what your mother expected of you. They have given their life for you. You are participating in their life. You are today, it is because of their blood, their bread. You are part of them. You lead a life what they wanted you. Let them live in you. In most of the funeral services and prayer meetings, I have always said this, the best tribute a person can give to a departed soul, the best tribute you can give to your father, give to your mother, the best tribute is two things: to live as they want you to live. To live as they want you to live. We say in Christ. And number two, remember them always. Remember them always. My dear brother, my dear sister, but even before his death, Jesus himself performed something, an anti-type of that ritual. And he said, take this bread, it's my body. Take this cup, this is the blood I shed for you. My blood. many parents will tell their children, you are my flesh. The wife is my blood, my flesh, my bone. Take, drink. And he said, do it in remembrance of me. What does it mean, remembering Jesus? Will they forget Jesus? Will they forget Jesus? No. It's not that they would forget Jesus. Remember what all I have told you. Remember my teachings. Remember the way that I have shown to you. Remember the calling I have given to you. My children, do it in remembrance of me. Do it in remembrance of me. My dear brother, my dear sister, Jesus constituted the Lord's Supper. Jesus didn't tell them, when should they take that supper? When should they have this Holy Communion? Jesus never gave them any instruction of that. Jesus never gave them any instruction of that. Next day, Jesus died. After 50 days, the church was born in the upper room. We don't know how they were practicing it. Paul was not there. Paul was not one among that 11 who witnessed that Lord's Supper. We don't know how Paul got that. Nearly after 30 years, Paul was writing to the Corinthians. That practice has come to the church. But that practice, there was some error. It was little practice in an erroneous way. So it has become necessary to Paul. So Paul was writing this to the Corinthians. We read about this only in Corinthians chapter 11 and also a reference in Corinthians chapter 10. Corinthians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 16 and 17 and 21. Please make a note of these things. I'm encouraging you to bring your notebook and take down these notes. And chapter 11 is almost designated for this, and especially from verse 20 to 34 or to the end of the chapter. This was constituted in the upper room, recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We don't have a vivid reference of this record in the book of John. But after, say, 30 years or something, the practice of this Holy Communion, as it is now called by some group of people, or the Lord's Supper or Eucharist, there was some errors. So Paul exposes those errors to the congregation. And very clearly he says, that's a very powerful passage. In verse 23, he says, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. He received of the Lord and he delivered unto the church. Now say, for example, Paul received of the Lord and delivered unto the church. Now the church says, tomorrow, Tambi Simon or Tambi Emil, somebody comes and tells me, I received a new revelation that nullifies the revelation given to Paul. the apostle. What they bind, we can't lose. What they lose, we can't bind. So what Paul has received, he has delivered to us. Now I can't say I have received something. Now tomorrow saints cannot tell me, yes, last night I had a dream, this is what the Lord told me in a dream. Then I doesn't mean that I should accept it. He is also a child of God. He is also a child of God. Or another day Jenny cannot come and tell me, I had a dream, this is what the Lord told me. Somewhere the scriptures are canonized. Paul has received of the Lord, and Paul has given that, delivered that to the church. Now again, Timothy hasn't received a new revelation, or Titus has received a new revelation, later Polycarp, and one day Pastor Sundaram, another day Robert Simon. It is what Paul has received and delivered to the church. What is that? He says, and when in the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you, this do in remembrance of me, etc., etc., etc. My dear brother, my dear sister, so we are here to participate in that Holy Communion. As when there was an error that was going around in the church at Corinth, it has become necessary for Paul to give a right perception about what is what. So today I am standing in that position. Every month, second Thursday, we have got VOT Forum. And for the last few months, every last Tuesday, we have got VOT Prayer Fellowship. So in that prayer fellowship, we freely share our thoughts, we discuss the doctrines, what is the truth, and also we edify one another. Then one of the pastors, a very sincere pastor, well-educated man, he brought an issue about an online communion service. It was very new to hear an online communion service. And since I was not exposed to something like called an online communion service, I request one of our brothers to help me with that. What is that exactly? And he sent a video. I'm not here to pass judgment on somebody's teaching. The Bible clearly says anyone who is spiritual will not judge others. The Bible says one who is spiritual should discern all things. Because there is an accessibility for the believers of Carmel Christian Assembly, whom the Lord has given into my hands, I got a direct responsibility to expose what is right, what is wrong. My dear brother, my dear sister, it is not about what somebody is not judging on somebody has preached, it discerning on that teaching. And also again I say the reason, because the accessibility for our believers. And I am responsible. When something was going wrong, if Paul was correcting the church, what should not be done, what should be done. And I want to bring to you or expose three errors in the clipping what you noticed. And I want to be careful about it. If somebody thinks, no, that is right, you have got freedom to make your own choice and you can be in that church. What we believe, I share with you. What I believe, what I understand from the scriptures. So three things. One is, as that dear pastor was, pastor raised up on that day, on that online communion. Online communion. Now I don't want to spend much time on that online communion. And this evening we have got open for, if you have got any question on that online communion, or how an online communion could differ from worship services of different churches online. So what is an online communion service? How that could be different and how that is not possible? Now we are in the days of computer era. Everything online, everything online. We talk about online trade. This morning when I came, I asked our media champions whether they know Sachin Bansal. They say, Sachin Bansal, we know only Sachin Tendulkar. Then one of our smart media persons, yes, I know this bun butter jam. Sachin Bansal is the founder of the, one of the founders of the Flipkart, and he's the owner of Flipkart. So yesterday, iPhone 7 and iPhone 7 Plus was launched in India. So it is said in the business magazines, as a business strategy, on that launching day, Sachin Bansal, the owner of Flipkart, he acted as a courier boy. Anybody knew this news yesterday in Bangalore? Nobody. As a courier boy, this Sachin Bansal, he went to a few houses and he handed over the handset. He acted as a courier boy, as a business strategy. So what is an online trade? In online trade, everything is not online. You choose the product on online, you can even make a mistake. You choose the product on online and you place the order on online. Only these two things you are doing in online. And the third one, payment can be on online or cash on delivery, or they will swipe on your cart at the time of delivery. So you choose the article online and you place the order online, payment either on online or in person. But 100% that product, that material, that element is delivered only by person. It can come by courier, it can come by post, it can come by speed post, but that commodity has to be delivered. It cannot come in the air. It cannot be online. It cannot be a wave mode. That iPhone cannot come to reach you in a wave mode. Maybe certain applications, software, they are not hardware. Though software can reach you through waves, alayhal. But hardware can never reach you through waves. Even Sachin Bansal has to come in person to deliver that hardware. What Peter preached 2000 years ago, even today we can read. Maybe that's not the total, but a part that's given to us, we read. We preach on that. We preach all over the world. The word is spirit and life. What Peter preached 2000 years ago, today we can listen. We can hear. The bread what Jesus gave 2000 years ago, we cannot eat that bread. It's a hard thing. It's a material. What we call technically, it's an element. And that element cannot reach somebody online. There is a vast difference between listening to a message online in YouTube and receiving an element online, it's impossible. You cannot receive an element online. What can be an alternative? Now somebody says, I will launch that iPhone, I will launch this iPhone 7 in my office with all fanfare, and in your kitchen you make your own iPhone 7 and you use it. I launch iPhone 7 in my kitchen, my office, and you make your own iPhone 7 and you use it. I plus an element before the camera, you make your own element and eat it. It is something like that. I will launch an iPhone 7 in my office and you make your own iPhone 7 and you start using it, because it involves an element. It cannot be online, and online is not everything totally online. My dear brother, my dear sister, there's a vast, incomparable difference between listening to a song, listening to a message online, and participating. Lots of aware elements are involved in online, and I don't want to take time on it. I want the church. There's nothing called a virtual church. There's nothing called an online communion. And if you believe that stuff, and not again somebody else believing that, if you also believe that stuff, I encourage you, be a part with them. I don't believe it. I could not rationalize it. With the love and affection I say, I didn't die for you. Christ died for you. But I know the pains I have taken. It is a type of a spirit of martyr. Waiting in the presence of God, in bringing message, week after week, for every Bible study, God is a witness. My wife is a witness. Our dear brothers, very much Selvam, Robbie, Madhu and others, they are a witness. Why do I say this? We love you. And if you receive what I am sharing with you is the word of God, be with me. When somebody is totally contrary, we have to be very careful. I love you all very much with love. I love to tell you. So number one, online communion. Number two, children participating in it. I was discussing this with a very senior person who was a diocese priest, who has totally come into the life of the Lord. The very danger, it's not even in the Roman Catholic or CSI. Now these questions come. Children, are they saved? Are they Baptist? So when I was discussing this with that father, I call him father affectionately because he was a parish priest. Now he doesn't want to be called a father. To identify his background, as we say, Father Bergman Saya. When I was discussing with him, he said, they openly say, to participate in the Lord's Supper, salvation is not necessary. To participate in the Lord's Supper, baptism is not necessary. Now, child in the house, if the child participates, I'll explain that later, unworthily, the child will be participating its own damnation. Its own damnation. When the jailer and everybody in that house were baptized, a padre who studied in Oxford University, Cambridge University, his BD degree. He asked me one day, what, Pastor? You say that only those adults can be baptized. In the house of jailer, the Bible says, all are baptized, all in the house were baptized. That's what the Bible says. You say there's no child in that house. I said, sir, do you say there was a child in that house? He said, there could have been a child in that house. I said, there could not have been a child in the house. Hey, it's only praying with words. I said, no, the Bible says there was no child in that house. How do you say? Yes, the Bible says there was no child in that house. How do you say? He believed with all in that house. He received the word of God gladly with all in that house. He took baptism with all in that house. All in that house were able to receive the word of God gladly. All in that house were able to believe. All in that house were baptized. My dear brother, my dear sister, even this also, I don't want to spend much time. In our church, we love children. We love children. We don't see in the Bible very clearly what age a child could participate, or what is the condition for a child to be participate, whether a baby in arm can also just keep, we can keep a small bit in it, a small sip of that grape juice, or we touch the finger and put it in its mouth, or from what age we can give that bread and wine. The Bible is not clear about it. But when we read the word of God, the Bible is very clear who all are added to the church. The Jewish tradition is very clear. One is born to a Jewish parents, he is not circumcised. In the Judaistic religion, he is circumcised when he was 8 days old. But Jesus said, believe and be baptized. Believe and be baptized. They understand this blood was for the remission of my sins. His body was broken for my sake. He comes to that knowledge of that understanding. My dear brother, my dear sister, the Bible is not clear what age we can give or what age they can be brought to this Holy Communion. But by practice, by understanding the truth, by understanding the truth, we strongly believe. We encourage our children to be baptized. We encourage our children to have the forgiveness of their sins, their experience of salvation, that born-again experience. I understand Billy Graham received Jesus Christ as his personal Savior when he was 4 years old. Almost at the same time, Pepsi came into this glorious experience. I received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior when I was 9 years old. But I could not follow. I could not. There was no follower for me. I'm very happy in the same age, Sister Premi came into this glorious experience. And she has been steady from that time. Maybe a second touch was necessary for me when I was 21. My dear brother, my dear sister, we don't know what's that age, but the children, they believe and they were baptized. In our church, children, those who believe are baptized and they participate in the Lord's Supper. This is what we practice. This is what we practice. Not every child in the house. In a little bit over enthusiasm because of a wrong understanding of the teaching, I understand some parents, they give this bread to the children, they give a small sip of this grape juice even to their children. That's practiced everywhere, even in churches like this. As a teaching, we don't believe in that. Now I come to the third one, that's the most important thing. Eating flesh and drinking blood. Eating flesh and drinking blood. So I love to tell you, what is this bread and this cup? Are we eating bread and cup, or drinking of the cup, or we are eating flesh and drinking blood? We read in 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 27, in those 5 verses, Paul repeatedly says, took this bread, this cup. Now, I don't have time to read all those 5 verses. Repeatedly, Paul was saying, this bread, after nearly 35 years, Paul was using that phrase, this bread and this cup. This bread and this cup. After the apostolic age, the first century, we don't have much reference of what was happening, maybe in the second century. From third century, the dark days have come. From the seventh century, the Roman Catholicism is come. My dear brother, my dear sister, the pagan festivals, everything came in. We have got different type of erroneous teaching, and that became the church. That's what Jesus said, a woman, she took a lump of leaven and kept it in the unleaven, and she made the whole unleavened flour leaven. A small portion of the Babylonian teaching came into the church that made the whole church Babylonianism. It was the Babylonian teaching with a label, Christianity. The Babylonian teachings and festivals, rites and rituals with a label, Christianity. And the Reformation was taking place in the 16th century. So from the 16th century, 1500 and odd, I'll show you 3 different teachings almost sprang forth in the same time. Almost sprang forth in the same time. You can just make a note of it. All from the 16th century. You can make a note of it. One is transubstantiation. We have got this morning Brother Pelik and his wife, Joe, Noella, those were hardcore Roman Catholics. This is the practice even today in the Roman Catholic Church. This is what I was discussing with that father. That's called transubstantiation. I'm not just talking something rubbish. Hours and hours and hours, with a real sincerity to God, our own people, I took this matter with you. Transubstantiation. Almost in the same time, in the same century, 16th century, the second thing came as consubstantiation. Consubstantiation. And the third one, almost parallel, the consubstantiation is by the Lutherans. And in the same 16th century, memorialism or symbolism. Now we have got in our hands 2 material. One is what was in the first century, what was in the upper room, and what after 30 years Paul taught to the church at Corinth. That's on one side. Then we have got 3 different teachings and practices in the 16th century. Since the 16th century, even today it is in practice. And one of those things only you listen to in that video clipping. This is, all 3 these things are in vogue even today. Now I'll explain to you what is transubstitution. As I said, some of our Catholic friends, those who are in the Roman Catholic, they know very well. Either transubstantiation means when the priest was pronouncing the prayer, when the priest was solemnizing or pronouncing the prayer on those elements, bread and wine, it's a literal wine, bread and wine. When the prayers are proposed on it, that substance, that element, it is changed into the real body of Jesus Christ, the flesh of Jesus Christ, and that wine changes into, because of that prayer, the wine changes into the real blood of Jesus Christ. So they call it, when they participate in the Lord's Supper, because of this transubstantiation, they are participating what they call real presence. The real presence. So when this started, and if you want, you can make a note of it. I don't want to get into many of these details, but I'll have to tell you, it was in 1545 to 1563. It was at the Council of Trent. It was in the Council of the Trent. This teaching came into vogue. It wasn't practiced earlier. It was made a degree by the consideration of the consecration of the bread and wine. There takes place a change of the whole substance. Because of the consecration of bread and wine, there take place a change of the whole substance of the bread into the substance of the body of Christ our Lord. And of the whole substance of the wine, not a part, the whole substance of the wine into the substance of his blood. This change, the Holy Catholic Church has fittingly and properly called transubstantiation. Transubstantiation. Because they are the presence of Christ himself, Catholics worship and adore the elements. Because it was the body of Christ, it was the blood of Christ, Catholics, they knew very well. The Lord has brought you out of that. They worship the elements. My dear brother, my dear sister, it was in paragraph 1376 of CCC. I got 10 arguments against it, and I'm afraid the time will not permit me to go through all the 10 arguments, but very briefly I tell you. When Jesus Christ was symbolically breaking the bread, he broke the bread, he took the bread and broke it. And he said, "Eat, this is my body broken for you." When Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you," his body was not at all broken. His blood was not at all shed. And those who are participating in that ritual, in that upper room, never imagined they are eating the body of Jesus Christ. They never imagined that they were drinking the blood of Jesus Christ. A Jew is not expected to drink blood. Many times, Jesus said, "I am the bread of life." It doesn't mean a literal bread. It doesn't mean a literal bread. If I say somebody is taking my life, it doesn't mean somebody has taken my life. When Jesus says, "You are eating my body," does it mean that you are eating? Jesus says, "I am living water." Doesn't mean he's water. He says, "If you drink of me, you will not thirst." It doesn't mean you can drink Jesus. Jesus says, "I am the door." Jesus says, "I am the way." You cannot walk on Jesus. There's so many areas where Jesus is talking symbolically. Cannibalism was never practiced by the Jews. They never thought they are eating the real body of Jesus Christ. Christians were criticized for this earlier when the Roman Catholics started practicing this. Recently, I was listening to a WhatsApp clipping where one of the Tamil politicians was speaking against Christianity. Christians are cannibals. Jesus told his disciples to eat his body, to drink his blood. My dear brother, my dear sister, they never thought that we are eating the body of Jesus Christ. They never thought they are drinking the blood of Jesus Christ. Paul repeatedly said, when you eat this bread, you are eating only bread. When you drink of this cup, you are drinking only what is in that cup. What is in that cup? Jesus said, the fruit of the vine. It was a different phrase what Jesus used. And they say that phrase may speak about grape juice, not the fermented wine. My dear brother, my dear sister, now time doesn't permit me to get into it, whether that can be leaven or not leaven, the yeast can be in it or yeast cannot be in it, not getting into it. The Bible is not speaking about it. But we understand from the totality of the Bible. You search the word of God, you shall have eternal life. You search the word of God, you shall have eternal life. Then what about the doctrine? Jesus Christ was crucified only once for our sin. In every mass, Jesus cannot be crucified. And Jesus was nailed to the cross by the Romans. The servant of God, the priest of God, the officiant at the table cannot break Jesus. Can I have the atrocity to break Jesus? Can I have a mystic power turn the wine into blood? My dear brother, my dear sister, the wine has turned into blood. Okay, there is some leftover grape juice. Our boys are drinking. Now it's a question whether they are drinking blood or wine. Are they drinking grape juice or blood? I pray grape juice turned into blood. In a mystic way. Something is left over. And somebody else is drinking. Are they drinking blood or wine? How this mysticism is. When there was a puja for their god, and after the days of puja, it was their custom. We don't question it. It is their custom. They go and dissolve that idol in waters, in sea or in well, where there is a large quantity of water. They dissolve that idol. And our former chief minister in Karnataka, they criticize that practice and say they dissolve their gods in water. For that, a leader of that religion gave an answer. That answer was worse than the criticism. Just rationalize that answer. He said it's only a clay. When we pray for that clay becomes our God. And when our pujas are over, again it becomes the clay. We are not dissolving God. We are dissolving only that clay. Because we use that for the purpose of worship, we dissolve it with reverence, sacredness. So what was the answer? It was the clay. When we prayed, it became a god. And when we stopped prayer, God has become a clay. So who is more powerful? Through my prayer, I can make a clay into a god. And when I don't pray, God becomes a clay. I'm not criticizing their faith. It is their faith. It is almost equal to that. When I pray for wine, that becomes blood. When I stop praying, blood becomes water. Blood becomes grape juice. My dear brother, my dear sister, the rock can be smitten only once. Jesus was crucified only once. Now he is seated at the right hand of the Father. The word, very word, mos means extermination. Illamapur. Pali. In Tamil they call it Tirupali. They go to church for Bali, to sacrifice Jesus. We are going to participate in the Lord's Supper. I love you to remember, you are not cannibals to eat the flesh of Jesus Christ and drink the blood of Jesus Christ. That's cannibalism that was not practiced in the evangelical churches. But even today, the Roman Catholics, they believe the real presence of an element, and it was in their Catholic catechism. Catechism means teaching. In the Catholic catechism, that it's the real presence of God. That's why they adore it, they worship it. Paul never told the Corinthians to worship it. Even about that, any other epistle we don't even read. My dear brother, my dear sister, I got 10 arguments probably. I'll give that to you later, or if you want, you can get it from me. My dear brother, my dear sister, why that is wrong? Almost I covered all those things. And very quickly, let me go to that second one, consubstantiation. The Latin word con means together. Con means together. So that is another practice. It was from Martin Luther. Consubstantiation means it is only bread. It is only wine. No doubt about it. Paul said this bread, this wine. It is not bread. But God is also present, not flesh or blood. God is also present in that element. Why they were to bring something in between in his days, in the same 16th century, when this Reformation was breaking out? There was a great saint from Switzerland by name Zwingli. Zwingli was saying, it is only symbolic. It is only symbolic. And there were many followers with Zwingli. In those days they were called radical. In many areas they were just opposite to the Roman Catholic Church. All in the 16th century. So Martin Luther, or the Reformation Church, or the Lutheranism, was playing always something in between, compromising. They really brought in a Reformation, that's what equal to Sardai Church. But in their baptism, they compromised with infant baptism. In this Holy Communion, they wanted something in between. They don't want to offend the Roman Catholics, those who are coming. Even today we see that type of a different type. This is right, this is not wrong. This is right, or this is not wrong. Something in between. I just tell you a few things about how this Reformation was getting into compromise. I said the baptism is one thing. The other thing, the cross. When the followers of Zwingli, they said, no image. We should not have any image. The Roman Catholic, they got crucifix. They got an image nailed to the cross. That was used by the witches and the witchcrafts. When they want to pronounce a curse on somebody, they'll take a cross, they'll write his name on the top of the cross, they'll make an image, and they'll keep that image on the cross. They put pins, nails on the hands and the feet of that image, and they pronounce curses on it. That was called crucifixed, fixed on the cross, crucifixed. It was a practice many years before Jesus Christ was crucified. They continued that practice. And when the Reformation came, they said, no, we should not have these images. And some people were scared. If we don't have these images, devils will come in. They wanted to have cross. So Lutheranism brought something in between. Okay, you can have a cross, but you can have an empty cross. You can have a cross, but you can have an empty cross. So they were bringing in something in between. They are bringing in something in between about baptism, about cross, about this communion, consubstantiation, and about the festivals, how the Catholics celebrated the festivals, the same Babylonian festival in the Reformation, how they wanted to celebrate the festivals, etc., etc. I want to tell you, I want to show to you what the Bible says about the Reformation Church. That is the Sardai Church. Because of this Reformation, only these deliverances came. But the problem with the Reformation Church, chapter 3, the book of Revelation, verses 1 and 2. My dear brother, my dear sister, you may know my sincerity. You know how many hours I would have taken to prepare these things and to study on these things. And the Lord constrained me to speak to you, because I have got responsibility concerning you. It's not judging on others, bringing to you what we believe, and I want you to warn against what we don't believe. In Revelation chapter 3 verses 1 and 2, and unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, that the Reformation church. Sardis means Reformation. These things saith he that had the seven spirits of God and seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest. The Reformation church has a name that it lives and art dead. The Lord's verdict on that church. And he continues in verse 2 of the latter part, I have not found thy works perfect before God, or complete before God. There was a Reformation, but they sealed with that Reformation. They were not moving towards perfection. They are not moving towards perfection. There were a number of errors. Consubstantiation is another error. In the same time, Council of Trent and the Reformation of Martin Luther and the Reformation of Zwingli, Anabaptist, etc., etc., all in the 16th century, the third teaching, almost they all are similar, contemporary teachings. We have got for the last 500, 600 years, these teachings with us. These teachings with us. These teachings are in vogue even today. The Roman Catholics exclusively follow the transubstantialization and real presence, and the Orthodox Catholic, the Orthodox Syrians, they don't use the word transubstantiation, but still they believe in the real presence. That is from the 16th century. And 16th century in Lutheranism, they believe in the consubstantiation, that it is only blood, it's only bread, it's only wine, and also God's presence in it. My dear brother, my dear, even in those days, Zwingli and others were against them. In the year 1522, all in the same 16th century, in 1522, the first revolt of Zwingli was his controversy that attacked the custom of fasting during Lent. So in the 16th century, there was a Zwingli. He said, during Lent, there is no fasting. It's a pagan festival. Jesus was not crucified like that. There was no fast before Jesus' crucifixion. This is where Lutheranism was playing something in between. They accepted that fast. So this is today we are saying no fast. It is not today. Today we don't have fast. Some of the Pentecostal churches, they got Lenten fast. In the 16th century, Roman Catholic, they had a Babylonian festival. Lutherans, the Reformation church, they followed it in a different way. In the same 16th century, Zwingli said, there is no fast, you should not fast. Because they were not fasting, people were killed. Even today, suppose this rain is given to the Christians, those who follow the Lent, what they'll say? Those who don't follow the Lent, they are not Christians. They don't have these privileges. They'll pass that rule. We may have more religious freedom and somebody else rules. Then these type of Christians will come to power. The Christians were killed. Zwingli's followers were killed for history. You know that Zwingli was murdered. When he was 49, Zwingli was murdered for his teachings. In today's light, we say, don't say Zwingli is everything is right. But they were bringing this into the limelight. Zwingli was against the corruption in the church, and many things. Zwingli, only first, he was against the what we call the celibacy. Zwingli only promoted clerical marriage, etc., etc. My dear brother, my dear sister, and about this communion, Zwingli said, it's only symbolic. We are doing it only in remembrance of Jesus. We are doing it only in remembrance of Jesus. And his friend John Calvin, that's again in the 16th century, he gave a better understanding What Zwingli said, what we say today sacrament, when we take baptism in water, in baptism in water, there's no mysticism in the power. And as an atheist said, when you are dipping a pig into the water, you can't take a pup out. By dipping a pig into the water, you can't take a pup out. There is no magic power in the water. Again, again, the church will slide. We read in the Old Testament, after the days of Joshua and the days of Judges, again and again, Israelites were taken into captivity. Again and again, the church is taken into captivity. Today, in the name of Punida Yatra, holy tour, they want to go to Jerusalem. They think it's a holy tour. There's no difference between going to Mecca, going to Tirupati, or going to Velangani. They want to go to Jerusalem. They understand that as a holy tour. Going to Jerusalem, I am not against it. I love to go to that place if the Lord permits. My dear brother, my dear sister, just going and seeing what the Pallava kings were doing in Mahabalipuram, I love to go and see what was happening in the Bible places, what I read in the Bible. But absolutely, I call it a nonsense to say it's a holy tour. I say it makes no sense. When I say nonsense, I mean it makes no sense. It's not holy tour. Now, the extension of the holy tour, some pastors, I understand, baptized pastors, they go and take second baptism by some rabbis in River Jordan. The baptism is complete only when we take baptism in River Jordan. They advertised all business. We take holy tour. Pastor so and so will give baptism of children at the River Jordan. They don't take baptism here. They want to take baptism in River Jordan. Because they believe some mystical power in the water. But when we say sacrament, we don't believe any mystical power in the water. We baptize a person in the name of the Lord, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. When he is baptized into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, it's a physical act. There's no mystic power in it. It has got a spiritual impact. We believe he comes into the family of God. Those who are baptized into Christ, they belong to him. You are baptized into Christ. You are coming into Christ. As in the marriage, it's a physical ceremony. A boy and a girl, maybe holding their hands, they give a promise. I exchange a ring, a thali. It's a physical act. When they do the physical act, they become one. They become husband and wife. Legally, spiritually, in the presence of God, they become one. Till death put them asunder. A physical act has got a spiritual significance. So Calvin said, when you participate in the Lord's Supper, it is an ordinary bread, it is ordinary wine or grape juice. But when you participate in the name of the Lord, when you remember him, when you remember his death, you have got fellowship with God. Not just body, blood separately. You have got fellowship with God. And by participating in this physical act, we have got our fellowship. We have got our fellowship with the Lord. Earlier occasion, when I listened to the speech, a fire speech of a politician, he's not wrong, because he heard only about transubstantiation, Christians eating the body of Jesus and drinking the blood of Jesus. He spoke against it. That time also I sat in the church, and really I wanted the Lord could give me an opportunity, I can go and help him. It's only one teaching, that's transubstantiation. All Christians don't believe in that. I love his rationalistic thinking. But his rationalistic thinking is only with a part of, and I understood when I was talking this to somebody, I don't know how much true, I understood that that speaker is actually from the Roman Catholic background. Just I don't share the names now. My dear brother, my dear sister, what do we believe? What I want you to discern with others. All these three teachings which are in work today, which are in practice today, transubstantialism, consubstantialism, and memorialism or symbolicism. We believe in most of the Pentecostal churches, and from where I come, Pastor Sundaram, Sister Sara Navarro Jacobs, we believe, we do it in remembrance of Jesus' death. Now we are going to participate in the Lord's Supper. Very quickly from that passage, I show you five things what you should remember when you are participating in the Lord's Supper. My dear brother, my dear sister, very quickly, I read to you the solemn significance. Verse 23 down of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He broke the bread. Even after the prayer, he didn't break his body. He took the bread, he gave thanks, and broke the bread, and said, Take the bread and eat. This is my body which is broken for you. In a symbolic way, I am the door. I am the living water. This is my body. His body was still there. Nobody fell on him and ate his body. What do you mean by that? He became part and parcel of my life. I'm giving my life for you. It's a very simple thing. This is my body. In those days, somebody died in that prayer meeting, they always remember that person. Live as he taught. You are his body. You are his blood. It's a family function. We belong to his body. Paul says it's a mystery. We belong to his body. We belong to his blood. We belong to his bone. All three things are said in Ephesians. Not only body and blood. So Jesus said, this is my body which is broken for you. This do. Take bread, break it and eat it. This do in remembrance of me. And verse 25, after the same manner, also he took the cup. It's not even said what was in that cup. He took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Passover was over. Passover is not the New Testament. Passover was the Old Testament. Passover was the Old Testament. This is the New Testament in my blood. Tomorrow he's going to shed his blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it. Drink what is in that cup in remembrance of me. We are going to participate in the Lord's Supper. Number one, do it in remembrance of Jesus, the teachings of Jesus, the sacrifice of Jesus. Just don't believe any mystic power in this bread or in this wine. There's no mystic power. We all pray that it becomes the Lord's table. We pray that becomes the Lord's cup, not for a mystic power, spiritual value. An occasion, you do it physically, have a spiritual value. There's no mysticism in it. In baptism, there is no mysticism in it. In marriage union, there is no mysticism in it. But wife becomes the belonging of the husband. Not because of a mystic transubstantiation? The transubstantiation, I saw, it's a beautiful illustration. You have got idli, you have got pongal, you consecrate it, you pray. It looks like pongal, but the pongal has become a donkey. Now you eat that pongal, but you believe you are eating that donkey. That is transubstantiation. Through a magic power, a substance changed to another substance, but it appear, it is apparent, the physical appearance is the same. You take it to a scientific way, you put it in a scientific study, pongal will remain pongal. It won't look like kalitha. The property of kalitha will not be there, but because you prayed, pongal has become kalitha. The substance has changed. Bread has become the body of Christ. Grape juice has become the blood of Christ. Transubstantiation is changed. Because the change, it became the real presence. Because it became the real presence, you worship that, you adore it. We don't worship this bread. I know this bread is made by sister. She has done it with prayer. You can't imagine I worship that bread. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's very dangerous. It changes into blood when I pray. And when the prayer is over, again it becomes grape juice. Anybody can drink it. At least Catholics are very careful. Only Father will drink all the remaining wine. He won't allow others to drink. It doesn't become blood. I don't think boys, however, our brothers will drink it. It's a grape juice. My dear brother, my dear sister, this morning when you participate, remember what your Jesus has said, what your Jesus has preached, what your Jesus has lived for, what your Jesus wants you to do, what's the commission Jesus has given for you. Remember your father, remember your mother, remember what all they have said. What is the biggest tribute you can do it? Remember what they have said. So now you participate. When you participate, reverentially, remembrance of Jesus. And again, what we understand in verse 26, for as often as you eat this bread, not body of Christ, you eat the bread, you are not eating the body, you are not eating the flesh. And the translator made a wonderful mistake. Our weird afterbirth. And the preacher didn't give a correction also. But he noticed that because there was a pause. He noticed the error in the translation. Definitely there was a pause in it. But no correction was given. Our weird afterbirth. You are not going to eat Jesus Christ in a mystic way or in a real way. When you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show the Lord's death till He come. Two things. You exhibit Jesus' death in your life. How can I exhibit Jesus' death in my life? Leading a life void of sin. Having the forgiveness of sin. Continually being cleansed by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Even today, the blood of Jesus Christ speaking for us. We have to be very, very careful. This is another erroneous teaching in the Catholic. When you participate in the Eucharist, your sins will be forgiven. That could be their belief. That's for the remission of your sins. So when you participate, your sins will be forgiven. Our belief, we participate in it because our sins are forgiven. It is not a small difference. It is a difference between the earth and the sky. They believe the mystic power in the bread, the mystic power in the blood can forgive sins. But I believe because Jesus died on the cross, my sins are forgiven. I remember, I show in my life, my sins are forgiven. I show His death in my life. The very purpose I participate is not to eat His body, eat, not to drink His blood, but to show His death. That is what participate. You show His death in your life.
The as artists participate, you are showing his death. You are proclaiming to the world, why are you, daddy, eating this bread, drinking this cup?
I remember Jesus died for me.
I proclaim the death of Jesus to the children and to the children of children. The very purpose of participating in it, not because of the mystic power in it, but because of the spiritual value. You may say it's a small difference in words. Again I say, it's a difference between sky and the earth. And number three, when you participate in it, you remember my Jesus will come again for me. It's all filled with love. My Jesus will come again for me. Till that time, I remember his death. Again and again I remember. It's human to forget. Jesus said many areas, even about the Lord's Day. Remember to observe, because we fail to forget. When he was writing to the Galatians, he said, remember, so soon you forget Jesus died on the cross. Remember his death. In the past, when I turn to the left, I remember his death. When I turn to the right, I remember his coming. You are going to participate. On one side, remember his death. On the other side, see his coming. For the spiritual marriage, my Jesus, today he may come. I'm preaching in the English service, your privilege. I don't know whether the coming may be before the Tamil service, or I may die. He is coming again. Till he comes. And when I am ushered into him, into that glory land, I will be drinking with him the fruit of the wine. O Rashana Maravadi. Hallelujah, Jesus. What a glorious confidence it is. My dear brother, my dear sister, I've got a lot of things to share with you, fighting against time. So we participate in remembrance of him. We participate proclaiming his death. We participate looking forward to his coming. Verses 27, 28 and 29. Wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lamb unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. You are not eating the body or the blood of the Lord. You are eating this bread and eating this, drinking this cup. You will be eating the body unworthy. If you do it unworthily, you will be guilty. You'll be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. You are not eating the body. You'll be guilty of the body and the blood. That's why we say children should not participate in it. If they eat unworthily, the Bible says they are eating or drinking their own condemnation. Their own condemnation. Then what is eating worthily? What is eating worthily? My dear brother, my dear sister, in my life, there must be a testimony of why Jesus' body was broken, why the blood of Jesus Christ was shed on the cross. In a simpler word, an experience of salvation. An experience of salvation. A born again experience. Otherwise, I'll be eating it unworthily. Somebody in my house, born in my house, and the word house includes even the servants in our house. Maids and maidservants in those days, born in their house. My dear brother, my dear sister, we have to be very careful. It doesn't, Bible doesn't say anywhere how oft we should eat. But whenever you eat, eat worthily. Don't be guilty of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ that was broken for you, that was shed for you on the cross of Calvary from the bottom of my heart. Not I, but he that within me is crieth for you. He that within me is crying. Don't participate in it unworthily. You are trampling down the blood of Jesus under your foot. What does it mean? Literally, you are not pouring the blood of Jesus under your feet and trampling. You are not pouring a consecrated grape juice that turned into a blood and stamping on it. No, no, no. What is that? What is that? Oh, there is no forgiveness of sins. I live as I want. What is the use? Jesus died on the cross. How can that blood cleanse me? You are trampling down the blood that saved you, a backslidden. That is not literally trampling down the blood of Jesus. Spiritually you are doing it. Everything. It doesn't mean literally you have to pour down the wine on the floor and trample on it. My dear brother, my dear sister, participate in it worthily. Whether the body that was broken for you, whether the blood that was shed for you on the cross, for the remission of your sins, has any value in your life? Has shown any efficacy in your life? Then you are participating worthily. Otherwise, you are guilty of the body that was broken. You will be guilty of the blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary when your sins are not forgiven. I love to repeat it. Your sins are not forgiven because you drink of this cup. Because Jesus died on the cross, your sins are forgiven. It was a finished act. Again and again, Jesus is not crucified. I just give you the Bible passages. Hebrews chapter 6 verse 6. Hebrews chapter 10 from verse 10 to 14. Go home and read. You will very clearly understand if you are very serious about understanding it. My dear brother, my dear sister, number 5. He said, verse 28. But let a man examine himself. Not just a baby in that house. Not a child in that house. A person who participated in it. Somebody who is able to examine himself and let him eat. Again, he says, of that bread. Don't examine yourself and eat that body. Examine yourself and eat that bread. Examine yourself and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, for not discerning the Lord's body. 5 things. Remember Jesus. Number 2, in your life, proclaim his death. Number 3, look forward to his coming. Number 4, participate worthily. Number 5, to participate worthily, examine yourself.